Hello, good morning everyone. So welcome back to another class of the scientific programming with Python in NSD 609 classes. Today we are going to talk about one of the most important library in Python for scientific programming, which is NumPy. And the first thing that I would like to say is the difference between array and list. Okay. Okay, so first let's say we have a list of, okay, 2, 4, -3, 1, something like that. So if I multiply this list by 3, what do you think the result will be? So do you think it will be like 6, 12, minus 9, and 3? And the answer is nope. It will be, sorry, I forgot to put this comma here. Let's do that again. So it will be 2, 4, minus 3, 1, 2, 4, minus 3, 1, 3 times. So the way, so if it is a list, when we multiply a list with an integer number, it's just add the list together, like append the list together so that we have a longer list. But that integer do not exactly do anything with the element in the list. So in order to multiply 3 to each element inside the list, we have to use array. And in order to use array, we have to import NumPy. So first we have to import NumPy as np. So when we have NumPy, so first we will have to change this list to array. So I will declare another variable called arr array. And then I will say this array equal to np.array. np.array, and then I will put that list inside that array. So let's check the array. So here, this list, so and let's compare to the list. So here we have a list of 2, 4, minus 3, 1. We have array of 2, 4, minus 3, 1. The difference here is the array. Okay. So now let's do the same thing. We multiply array by 3, and we will have the result of 6, 12, minus 9, and 3 as we expected. So this is how we do the arithmetic operation to each element of the sequence of number, okay? And we also have couple more functions in NumPy that can be done with array. For example, we have array.mean. So this will calculate the mean value of the array. And in this case, the four number here, we have the average value of 1. That's kind of a coincidence. And then we have arr.std for the standard deviation. Then we have arr.max. So we have 4 as a maximum number here. We have arr.min for the minimum value, which is -3 here. We have arr.argmax. This will return the position of the max of the element with the maximum number. So in this case, we have 4 as the maximum number, and that is at the index of 1. So let's go up here. So we have the index 0 here and the index of 1 here. So yeah, it will return the position of the maximum index. And similarly, we will have the argmin, which will return the index of the element that had the lowest value. So in this case, it's gonna be -3. minus 3 has the index of 0, 1, and 2 as we expected. And then we also have the arr dot shape. Arr dot shape. This will tell us the shape of the array. So this has the array with 4 elements. So as you can see, if in the next section we will talk about two-dimensional array. So normally this will be row, comma, column, row, comma, column. We will see this more clearer in the next section of the talk. And then we have the array dot d type. So this will tell us that the data type of the array is int 32. Okay, so that is all I want to talk about the some nature of the array. So the next thing that I would like to talk about is the how do we use array in scientific programming. So it's very simple. We use array for vectors and matrix in scientific programming. Okay. Like that. We use array for vector and matrix. For vector and matrix. For example, okay, let me write it here. If we have a particle here, in the Cartesian coordinate, x, so let's say this is a particle one, and it has the coordinate of x1, y1, and then c1. And then we also have another particle here, and this, it has the core, is this the particle two, and it has the coordinate of x2, y2, and then c2, right? So normally we would like to represent this position vector. So let's say this is the origin point, and this is the position vector. The position vector r1 that describes the position of the particle one, and position vector r2 that describes the position of the particle two. Normally we will do like that. We will do r1 equal to x1 I, this is the unit matrix in the x direction, and then plus y1 j plus c1 k, right, in the x direction, y direction, and c direction. So we normally write this as an array. So let's say it's array of x1, y1, and c1. Okay, and same thing, if we have R2, then we can describe this R2 as an array of the X2, Y2, and then C2 as well. Okay, so let's see example in this case. For example, I say like I have R1, the position vector of the particle one, R1. Then it is equal to np.array. So we can put a list inside this array directly. So we can just say like we have like this particle is at 1 and 2 and minus 3 meter, and then we have r2, we have r2 equal to np.array, and this particle is at the Cartesian coordinate of, let's say, -4, 5, and 6 meters. Oops, have done something wrong. Okay, typo here. Now I have R1 and R2. So let's say we have R1 here, R1. We have R2 there. So we can have the position vector that's pointing from particle one to particle two here as the r12. This vector will be r2 minus r1 as a vector. Everything is a vector. So in order to do that, then we will have r12 equal to r2 minus r1. minus r1, and then let's clean this out. So we will have the vector of minus 539 minus 539. Okay, so this is the way we calculate the position, the directional vector from one point to the other. And so let's say, oh, I shouldn't delete that. Let's draw that again. We have r1 here, we have r2 there, and we have the position vector, directional vector r12, like that. So if we want to find the size of the r12, normally we will do, like, for example, if we have vector r as the xi plus yj plus ck, right, we will know the size of r, which is the distance, right, distance equal to x squared plus y squared plus c squared, and then we take the square root of those, right? This will be the distance between two particles. So in order to do that, we will do, so let's say r12 is an array, right? So we can grab each element in the same way we grab in the list and string. So if we grab r12 at the index of 0, then it will be minus 5. If we grab r12 at the index of 1, then it will be 3. So this way we can calculate a simple distance between particles. So we can do r12 x square plus r12 and then 1 at which is the value of y, and then square, and then plus the one two at the index of 2, and then square the value, and then we can take the square root of everything here by using np.sqrt. So when we do that, then we will have the size, when we will have the size of vector r12 as 10.72 meters, something like that. So this is one way to do it. Or actually, we have another function in Python that can calculate these for you. So we have the function called norm. So normally this size of the vector, we can call it norm of the vector. So that we can have we can call the function norm. So we have to call np.linearalgebra, linalg, linear algebra, and then we call n.norm, and then we put the r12 in there, and then we will have the same result. So this is the way we calculate distance between two particles in Python programming. Okay, so next, so we just have let's draw that again. I shouldn't delete it. I should have just left it there. So I have r1 here, I have r2 there, and they are vector. So and then we have the variable r1 for this guy and variable r2 for that guy, right? So in programming where you have to do to calculate a lot of position, it is not so convenient that we name this as r1 and r2. It will be better if we make a two-dimensional array, make a 2D array. And then in two-dimensional array, which is behave like a matrix, right? So then we will put x1, y1, and c1 here in the first row of the matrix, and then we will say we will put x2, y2, and then c2 as the second row in the matrix. So this will be a little bit easier in order to call the position. So let's say I have a position. I have a position, and I say, is this np.array, And in this array, I have to type two-dimensional array. So first, I have to put one bracket, and then I have to put another. So oh, sorry. So let's hit enter there, and then let's So first we type we have to put one bracket first, and then we have to put another bracket there so that it become two-dimensional array. And then we type the position of the first vector. So let's say it's 1, 2, and then -3. So we just put it there. And then we put comma, and then we place enter, and then we just put another list there. So as you can see here, we have two bracket, meaning that we have two-dimensional array. So the first row of the array will be 1, 2, -3, and the second row of the array will be -4, 5, 6. So when I run that, and when I check the value of the position, then it will be array in two-dimensional, right? So if you see this two bracket, is it two-dimensional? So let's go up here. So array with only one bracket, that is one-dimensional array, 1D array. So now we have two-dimensional array, okay? So in order to call array, we will grab the row. So if we grab the row, we can just do the same thing as grab an element. So if we say position of 0, then it will call the first row of the array. So let me draw that again. So we have the position. So let's do it. Let's draw it here. So we have the position array here. Okay. So the first row here, it will be position of the index 0, which is the first row. Okay, this is the first row. And then this one, we will have position of the index 1, which is the second row. Okay, this is the second row. So if I type like a position of index 1, then we will have kind of that. So now this position 1 and positions 0 and 1, we can grab each element. For example, if we grab 0, then it's gonna be x1 of the position 1. So let's say position 0, which is the first row of the array, and then we grab x, then it will return the value of 1, which is like that, okay? So in conclusion, we can grab something like that. So position, and then we grab row index. We grab row index, and then we grab the column index. Okay. So this is the way we deal with the position of particle in scientific programming. Okay, so let's repeat the calculation above here. So now we will have R12, which is the vector that point from position 1 to position 2. It will be the position 2, position 2, which is at the index 1, minus the position 0, which is the index 0 of the particle 1. When we do that, oh, something wrong. I missed the I here. Okay, when we do that, we can calculate the same thing. NP dot, let's call R12 first. Then we will have the same value as above here, right? Like right here. And then we can just do the same thing. NP dot linear algebra linalg.norm, and then we put r12 there, and then we will have the same value of the norm of the vector. And this is the way we deal with position of particle in Python programming. Okay. Okay, the next thing that I would like to discuss is before going to more details about the metric operation, I would like to talk about random number. So random number. Okay, so in NumPy, we can generate random numbers very easily. So normally what we do, so there are like about 3 or 4 main types of the random number. The first one is integer number. The first one is random integer number. In order to do that, we will call np.random. np.random, and then ran int, and then if you put the cursor inside this parenthesis, and then you press shift tab, then you will see the doc string of this function. So it say this will return the random number between low and high. So the low is inclusive and high is exclusive. So meaning that it includes the low but not including the high. So let's say I would like to generate random number between -5 and 4. So I have to put 5 there. So let's say -5 and 5. So I have to put 6 there. So it will generate random number of -5 and 5. And then it say the size of the array. So let's say size equal to 10. So it will just generate 10 number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And each number will be random number between -5 and 5, right? So we can also like generate like two of them. So if you see this bracket, only one bracket here, so it means we have one dimensional array. So we can generate like a two dimensional array using the same code, the same syntax. But we will just say like, I would like this size of the array to be like 4 by 4. Then we will have two dimensional array of the random number. Okay. The next random number generator that we use is the lan, np.lan.random.lan. So again, let's put shift tab to see what this does. So it said the random number in the given shape, like, right? So let's say I say dot land 5. So this will give me a random number that is equally distributed between the lower boundary of 0 and the upper boundary of 1, but the 1 is exclusive. So this will generate equally distributed number between 0 and 1. So as you can see, we have equally distributed here. So if we say like I want the random number of 5 by 5, then it will be something like that. So we have array in two dimensional, and we will have 5 row 1 2 3 4 5 and 5 column, and each will be randomly generated, and each number will be equally distributed between 0 and 1. And the last random number that we use is np.random.lan.lan n. So .lan n here, if you put if you place shift tab for the doc string, it will say this will be the standard normal distribution. So what does it mean, standard normal distribution? So in this case, in the first case of RAND, it will generate equally distributed number between 0 and 1, right? 0 and 1. But here for RANDN, is this standard normal distribution? Meaning that we have the normal distribution curve like that, normal distribution curve like that. And this normal distribution curve has the peak at 0, and it will have the like SD, 2SD, something like that, according to the normal distribution. But this one, the above here, it will be just equally distributed between 0 and 1, something like that. So this is the difference between RAND and RAND N. So let's try generate RAND N and 5 by 5 again. So we will have something like that. So as you can see, now we have negative number. And let's do something to test my claim. So if I say np.random.rand, and let's calculate, let's generate maybe 100 number. So I have 100 number in one dimensional. So if I say .mean, so the mean value will be at the center between 0 and 1, which is about 0.5. Now let's do the same thing, but we will change this to the standard normal distribution. So as you can see, the mean value will be go closer to 0. The first case, it will be the mean value will be closer to 0.5. So let's increase this number to 1000, and let's run this to cell again. So now we have like a clearer picture that this random number will be equally distributed from 0 to 1, and the average number will be 0.5. And this RAND N, it will be normal distribution curve, like a upside down bell curve, and the mean value will be 0. You can also calculate the standard deviation of the random number like that, and standard deviation of the normal distribution like that. Okay. So I think that is everything I want to talk about the array and then random number. So let's pause the video here before it will be too long, and then let's come back and continue discussion for NumPy in the next video. And thank you.